I know that we are on a software conference here, so for many of you, this is probably the first time you hear about power integrity, but don't be afraid, it's 101. Let me first explain to you why it's important to know something about power integrity, even if you are a software engineer. On this conference, we talk a lot about having reliable software, avoiding crashes, and things like that. But I have to tell you, unfortunately, that not every crash is because of bad software. So I know many of you try to improve your software, that is good. Some people even try to do metaprogramming a lot to solve every problem, but some problems are really hardware related. And here I have listed some things that can happen if you have a so-called power integrity problem. Having a bad power rail can cause a clock jitter, and clock jitter on the other hand can lead to noise on your power rail. It can cause having a signal integrity problem. So some of you maybe know this kind of diagram. It's an eye diagram. Here you have a high signal and here a low signal, and if you have a lot of clock jitter, or if you have a lot of noise on your power rails, this eye closes, and if this eye closes, you get faulty data transmission and you have to lower the speed of your transmission. And another thing that can happen to you, for example, if you have analog components like an A to D converter and you have a lot of power rail noise, your effective number of bits goes down. So the first thing we need to understand when we talk about power integrity is target impedance, or impedance in general. So since not everybody of you is an electrical engineer, let me explain first what an impedance is. So I think everybody of you knows the 3 ohms law. So for some of you, it's maybe just 1 ohms law. And the ohms law is this. It's basically impedance equals voltage divided by current. And why is this important for power integrity? Let me give you a very visual example. If you have a normal gasoline car and you have the headlights turned on and you try to start your car, what is happening is that the starter is drawing a lot of current from your battery. It's really a lot, maybe 100 amps or something like that. And what you can observe is that the brightness of your headlight goes down while the starter is turning. And the reason for that is that your car battery has an internal resistance, and you can just use this formula to calculate the voltage drop that you get because the starter is taking so much current out of your battery. And the same things can happen in your embedded systems. This time it's not the starter, it's maybe your microcontroller or like some high power peripherals that draw a lot of current. And in electrical engineering, when we talk about impedance, we are talking about the resistance at different frequencies. In this example that I just gave you, it was just about the resistance for direct current. But you can also have alternating current, so current that is drawn at different frequencies. And you can measure the resistance or impedance for every frequency and just draw it on a log-log graph. Log-log graph means every axis is drawn logarithmically. When we design an embedded hardware, And we want to design the power distribution network for it. One thing that is usually done is establishing a target impedance. And for example, I have drawn a target impedance here on this graph. And the way you arrive at this target impedance is usually you can look into the data sheet of your microcontroller FPGA and see what is the maximum allowed ripple. And maybe you have 1%. And then you need to know what is the maximum current for each frequency. And that's the difficult part, because the current profile depends on the code you write, on the peripherals you turn on and off. So it's not really possible to get an exact current profile. What you can do is just use estimates for your current. So you just use the worst case current, and then you say this is the maximum current for every frequency, and then you get this flat line by using this formula. And the goal is now to have your to design your power distribution network in a way such that its impedance is always below this line. So the impedance of your power distribution network should be in this area. Now, some of you might wonder, what is this line? The reason for this line is that every power distribution network or every electrical conductor in general has a parasitic inductance that you cannot avoid. So at some point, you need to allow the increase of impedance. And just quick notice, if you see in a log-log graph a line that goes with an upward slope, 20 dB per decade, or just maybe here you can say 45 degrees, that's an inductor. And because we know that, we just need to look at our system and say what is the highest frequency of currents that can happen in our system. This can be the clock frequency, or if we know that the I/O ports can only toggle at 1/10 of the clock frequency, it could be 1/10 of the clock frequency. So here in this example, I have chosen 10 megahertz. So now we have our target impedance and we can start to design the power distribution network. Most people already know that you have a lot of capacitors on a PCB and they are good for stabilizing power. So that's already known for a long time. And I have to say, when I started microcontroller together with Odin, it was like 1999, we started with the 16F84 PIC microcontroller. We did not need to worry about power integrity because it's 10 megahertz and there's no problem, you don't need it. But now even the microcontrollers run in the hundreds of megahertz range, and it becomes a mainstream thing, this power integrity. So we know we add capacitors to our PCB to stabilize the power, or to put it differently, to lower the impedance of our power distribution network. But let's see what a real capacitor actually looks like, because this is a schematic symbol of a capacitor, but in reality it always has a parasitic inductance and also a parasitic resistance. And if you use a VNA to measure these properties, you get a graph that could look like this. And here I have calculated the capacitance, the ESR, and the inductance. So when we, for example, install this little capacitor, it's like a 100 nanofarad on our PCB, we can improve the target impedance in this frequency range. But there's something more that you need to know, because here I have installed this capacitor on a test fixture that has like a very low mounting inductance. When you install this capacitor on your actual PCB, your mounting inductance will be much higher, so it will look differently. Another thing that can happen is when you just randomly put capacitors on your PCB, as I have done when I started with embedded systems, is parallel resonances can appear. And the funny thing about parallel resonance is that you get a resonance peak of the total impedance. And as we have seen before, we want to lower the impedance of our power distribution network. And what is happening now, the impedance goes up. I have shown you here a little example where I have like a capacitor and an inductance and a resistor. And this parallel resonance basically happens because of the parasitic elements of each capacitor. Each capacitor has an inductance, and if you have a parallel circuit of an inductance and a capacitor, you get the parallel resonance and the peaks. I have written the mass here on this slide. It's very basic, but let's just focus on the graph. This is the height of the parallel resonance peak, and you can calculate the height of this peak with this formula Q. The Q, the quality factor, is given here. It's Z0 divided by R series, and Z0 is a characteristic impedance of this RLC parallel circuit. But don't confuse this characteristic impedance with the characteristic impedance of transmission line. It's something completely different, and it's probably not so clever to use the same symbol, but I've done it because it's in the literature. This symbol is also useful. So you can just calculate the quality factor, and then you multiply it by Z0. And what you get is the height of the resonance peak depends inversely on the series resistance of your capacitor. So when you look for a capacitor, you often see low ESR as an advertisement. But as we can see here, low ESR is not always a good thing. In this case, it's maybe a bad thing, because a low ESR gives you a high resonance peak. We can also have a quick look at the RLC resonance, RLC series resonance. It's this is maybe more like what you have expected. If you have a series circuit, you get like a dip, and a dip is not so bad for our power distribution network. So we have just a quick look at this. So now let's do a practical design. We have already established our target impedance, drawn here with the dotted red line. And what we also have is our voltage regulator module. This could be an LDO or switching power supply. We can model this very roughly in a first approximation with a resistance and a inductance. So this is our VRM, and if we draw this VRM impedance here, we get this blue line. And what we see, because the VRM has a quite big inductance at some frequency, the impedance crosses our target impedance, and we would have a problem, because in this area where our power distribution network impedance is above the target impedance, we could possibly have a ripple or voltage noise on the power rail that is too large. So we need to install a capacitor on our PCB. Here I have drawn just lines for different capacitor values on the graph. And it's quite reasonable to choose a capacitor that goes right through this crossing point, because of course we could also choose this capacitor. It's even bigger, so maybe I should mention these are big values and here getting smaller. So we could choose a bigger capacitor than necessary, but the thing is, the parasitic inductance of capacitors greatly depends on their package size. And if you choose a very big capacitor, it's likely it comes in a bigger package and has a bigger parasitic inductance. So we don't want to choose it too big, just big enough is good enough. So we choose this capacitor. Couple of slides ago, I have shown you the parallel resonance, and I have shown you a model for a real capacitor with the parasitic inductance. So we install this capacitor on our PCB, and we measure the impedance with maybe a VNA, and we get this graph. And what we see is we have a parallel resonance peak, because we have the inductance of our voltage regulator module and the capacity of our bulk capacitor. And we have also seen that the height of the resonance peak is inversely proportional to the ESR value of our capacitor. So what do? To lower this peak, we choose a bulk capacitor that has a higher ESR value, and a good value to choose it to have the ESR value about the same value as our target impedance. If we do this, we get a total VRM, or I should say power distribution network impedance, that looks like this pink line. And this pink line looks much better than this PDN impedance. And the only thing I have changed is increase the ESR value of this capacitor. But there's another thing that we see. The green line here is just the capacitor with its parasitic inductance. And here, therefore, the impedance of this real capacitor goes up, because at higher frequencies, the inductance starts to dominate. And we are above our target impedance, because the inductance of our bulk capacitor is still too big to keep the total impedance below the target impedance at high frequencies. So what do we do? We do the same thing again. We just install another capacitor, and these are usually the so-called decoupling capacitors, small ceramic capacitors right next to the device, maybe microprocessor or FPGA. Same method as before, we look for the crossing point, select the right capacity, and install it. And hopefully, if we install it correctly, we get a PDN impedance that looks like this. And here we see our impedance is, even at high frequencies, is it's always below the target impedance. And if we can achieve that, we are good. If you look at very, very high-end stuff like gigahertz, maybe, or even starting at 500 megahertz, there are also resonance modes, and the PCBs themselves can be modeled. Like if you have ground planes, they are a kind of capacitor and they can resonate. So that would be a more advanced topic, but for a start, it's just good if you know this. I have just mentioned that it's important how you install the capacitor on your PCB, because the mounting inductance is a key thing. And especially for the decoupling capacitors, in order to get below the target impedance at very high frequencies, the inductance needs to be low. And some people have done measurements, they measured different styles, different ways of mounting a capacitor to a PCB. Here we see like thin wires, and here we have a wide trace, and here we have the vias very close to the capacitor. Here we have the vias at the side, and then we have a smaller package, 402. And what we can observe is that going from here to here, the mounting inductance decreases. So what is the worst, to have a large package and vias far apart? And good, the best would be to have small capacitors and vias next to each other. And there's one specialty here to observe. Here, this one is colored red and this is black. This means that this is maybe the ground line, and this is the voltage, the VDD line. And why is this good? Because inductance, if you look at inductance, what is inductance? And inductance is usually a measure how much magnetic flux is created per unit current. And if a lot of magnetic flux or magnetic field needs to be created, it takes energy and it's equivalent to a high impedance. If we have here two vias where the current goes in opposite direction, the magnetic flux cancels each other out, at least part of, and therefore this lowers the total inductance. Therefore it's good to have the vias in this configuration, and therefore it's also an advantage if you put the vias here on the side and close to each other. And I don't have this on this slide, but one thing you can do is you can put the vias into the pad. It's called vias and pad. Not every PCB manufacturer supports it, but if it's possible, it's a good thing. If you have, let's assume you are a software developer and your microcontroller crashes just randomly from time to time. You tried everything, metaprogramming did not help. So what can you do? Okay, if you suspect there's a power integrity problem, the easiest thing you can do is probably just measure the ripple. But I just said easy. Let me check the time. Okay, easy. It's still, you can do a lot of things wrong. One thing that many people do is they measure the ripple across a capacitor, and that's not the best way. Let me explain why in a physical way. We have just talked about the mounting inductance, and the capacitor itself for high frequencies becomes a very low impedance, but the mounting inductance at high frequencies becomes a very high impedance. So we have the mounting inductance, the capacitor. And if you measure the ripple at high frequencies, there is a lot of current going through the wires conducting the capacitor to the power plants, because the capacitor at high frequencies looks like a small impedance. But if you have a lot of current going through a high impedance, like the mounting inductance, it causes a voltage drop. And this voltage drop is what you are missing when you measure the ripple across a decoupling capacitor. You measure basically the real ripple that is on the power plants minus the voltage drop on the mounting impedance. And if you just remove the decoupling capacitor, there's no current flowing and no voltage drop on the mounting impedance. So you should remove it and then measure it just on the pad with some specialized probes. Here I've shown you an image where I use a special power rail probe. I have one here to show you, and you can also solder a coax cable to it and measure it. This is for a demonstration. It's just I've used an FPGA board, but I did not put like a high load program onto it, so you don't see much ripple at all. But you can already observe that this one is measured with the capacitor still installed, and this one without the capacitor, and the noise that you can measure, the peak-to-peak voltage noise, is almost twice as much. And okay, if you are a hobbyist, you can just use your normal probe and measure, put it into AC, maybe AC coupling, but you cannot measure much lower than 10 millivolt. And the reason for that is that every oscilloscope has some noise. And for high-end oscilloscopes, you can switch between 50 ohm input impedance and 1 meg input impedance. And the lowest noise pass is usually the 50 ohm impedance input. So, but the 50 ohm impedance input is usually DC coupled. So what you can do, you can use a special power rail probe. Here I have used one from Rohde & Schwarz. You can also use one from Keysight maybe. And it has some advantages. It's 50 ohms AC coupled and has an integrated voltmeter, so you can also see the DC voltage. Let's say you have maybe discovered that the ripple is okay, but there's still a problem and you want to go one level deeper. What you can do is you can actually measure the target impedance, the log-log graph that I've shown. You can measure it, and the instrument that we use for this is usually a VNA, vector network analyzer. And what the vector analyzer can do, it's basically here. This is the VNA. It has one port that generates a signal and another port that is used for measuring the signal. And you somehow connect the output port to the input port, and the VNA shows you the ratio of the signal going out to the signal going in. And this parameter that you can measure is usually called S21. 2 means voltage at port 2 divided by the voltage at port 1. There's one little trick involved. It's actually not voltage divided at port 2. It's voltage at port 2 divided by half the voltage coming out of port 1. And why is that? It's because the VNA has 50 ohm internal resistance, and usually you connect it to a 50 ohm transmission line that is also terminated with 50 ohm, as we can see here, and then you have a voltage divider. And even if you have a perfect transmission line, you get only half the voltage at port 2 compared to the voltage here at the generator. So this is our setup that we use, the connection that we put onto the VNA. This is just a transmission line. And here we have the DOT device under test. It could be just a capacitor, or it could be our entire power distribution network. And the name of this connection is called two-port shunt through. Two-port because it uses two ports, and shunt through is because this DOT is here in a shunt configuration. Now we need to express the signal that we get at port 2 in terms of the DOT or ZX. And in order to do this, I have drawn this in a more schematical way. Here, this is the internal impedance of the VNA. Here's our DOT, and this is the termination of port 2. What if you have done a little bit basic electrical engineering, you know that here we have a parallel circuit of two resistors. You can write it like this or expand it to this. And then you have one resistor in series with another resistor and in parallel with a voltage source. And this is a voltage divider. The formula is like this. Just expand everything. We arrive at this formula. S to 1 depends on ZX, our DOT impedance or PDN impedance, like this. Then we can solve this formula for ZX because S to 1 is what we measure. Our VNA shows it to us, but we want to know ZX. So we solve the formula for ZX and we arrive at this formula. And good, we have done all the math, but here you see that there is just like a line drawn from the cable to the DOT, and that's a little bit tricky because actually what you do here is you use the Kelvin technique to measure a very low resistance because the PDN impedance is in the milliohm range, and the Kelvin technique works in a way that you have one pair of connections that is responsible for driving a current through the DOT and another pair of connections that is just sensing the voltage. That way you avoid a large voltage drop in your connection. A way to do this is to build like a special probes by yourself, and I've done this. You can use a semi-rigid coax cable, cut it and solder together the ground and the two center pins. What I've also done, I've used a probe, a spring needle, and soldered it also to the ground so that I can establish a good connection between these pins and my PCB. There are also professional probes available, like the one from PicoTest. It costs over 1,000 euro. And if you build this, it costs 20 euro. But of course, this one is better. So if you are a professional company and if you do high-end products, you probably want to buy one. If you just want to give it a try, you can build one by yourself. I have prepared a live measurement, and I think I will do that after the talk during the break because we are already a little bit low on time, so we will do that later. And this is just the instrument I'm using. It's a VNA from Rohde and Schwarz. I think you don't need the very high end, but I also don't recommend the cheapest one. Of course, if you are a hobbyist, you can use like something very cheap, but this is a good compromise. As you have seen, before, and I've shown it to you here. This is a two-port probe, and here we have still a little bit of wire that has a parasitic inductance, and when we measure our PDN impedance, we get a parasitic inductance that could be a problem if we want to measure very low impedances. And here I have used this probe and just put it on a sheet of metal that is conductive, and still I measure this inductance. And what this inductance is, it's a parasitic inductance of my probe. In order to avoid this parasitic inductance, you can use one port probe. So you basically have two probes, and you connect it right to your DOT from both sides, and then you don't have the parasitic inductance anymore. But the disadvantage is that, yeah, it's a little bit tricky to handle. You need a probe holders, or maybe you need somebody to help you with it. And here also, you can build it by yourself, just use a coax cable, or buy a professional probe. I have also a professional probe with me, this one from Rohde & Schwarz during the break. We can try that out. Another thing that you need to watch out for is the cable that you are using. And here I've shown you two measurements, but with different cables. If you use a very solid cable, it gives you good results. You can see here, we can measure down to the microohm, 140 microohm. But if I use this thin, flexible cable, I can only measure about 300 microohm. And this is because the cables have a shield resistance, and this shield resistance causes a ground loop that at low frequencies becomes apparent like this. There are professional cables available. They are quite expensive, couple of hundred euros just for a cable like this. But they have a combination of high flexibility and low shield resistance, and they are especially designed for measurements like this. Let's have a look at this ground loop that I have just shown you. Here's the setup that we know from before, and we see I have added a resistor symbol here and here. This stands for the shield resistance of the cable. Usually, this port is driving the current through this DOT, and what we want is that the current goes back through this cable. But as we can see here, the current that goes through the DOT can also return through the cable that is connected to port 2, and then we have a ground loop. And why is this a problem? Because of the resistance, we get a voltage drop. And so if we have a voltage drop here, we are not measuring the voltage across this DOT anymore, but we are measuring basically the voltage across this DOT plus the voltage drop across the cable shield. And one thing to improve this situation is use a cable that has a low shield resistance. And another thing that you can do is use a common mode choke like this one. It's a commercial product, but you can also build one by yourself, or you can use a differential amplifier. So much about the impedance and how to design a power distribution network impedance and how to measure it. There's another thing that might be interesting, and that's the stability of voltage regulator module, because it's quite closely related to the things that I have just shown to you. And when you have your whole setup, your PCB connected to power, and you measure the PDN impedance, you get maybe a trace like this. And what we can see here, this is maybe the decoupling or bulk capacitor, not so clear, but this peak here is from the voltage regulator module. And to verify that this peak is caused by the voltage regulator module is, you can just turn off the power of your PCB, and then this line goes upwards. If you turn power on, this line here drops down. So this is caused by the voltage regulator module. And as we can imagine, having a peak similar to what we have talked before, having a peak in the impedance profile is not good. And the worst thing that can happen to you is that your voltage regulator module is unstable and oscillates. And traditionally, to measure the stability of your voltage regulator module, you had to measure the open loop gain. And measuring open loop gain is not so easy if it's already installed on a PCB. You had to cut some traces. But there's another method available, and it's called the non-invasive stability measurement. And it can be done using the same way you measure the impedance of your power distribution network, just by running a special software. And the software does some math. It first takes the phase measurement, calculates the group delay, then takes the group delay, calculates the quality factor, and then this formula to calculate the phase margin. If you have a big phase margin, it's good. If the phase margin is very low, it might oscillate. One thing I have to mention, that this non-invasive stability measurement is actually a commercial software that you can buy for professional VNAs like this Roland Schwartz or Keysight. And the actual formula is not public. This is a formula that has still missing some parameters, some parasitic elements, but the result you get is roughly okay. So to understand the mechanism, you can just look at this formula. And here I have used this software. You need to do the impedance measurement, put the cursor on the right peak, and then push some buttons, and you get the phase margin. That's, I think that was the start to get into power distribution networks, but of course, you know, there are a lot of books, and I recommend, if you want to get started, I think this book is a good choice. It covers all the basics and is quite easy to understand. Then if you want to get more into measurement, I recommend this book here by István Novák. He is also a nice guy. I've talked to him. This book covers measurement using VNA. And if you want to go very deep and do simulations, you can have a look at this book by Stephen Sandler. I also have it with me. You can have a look at it during the break. Okay, are there any questions? Yes, Odin?
Sorry, on the mic. Okay, you mentioned at the very, very beginning that the inductance correlates with package size.
Yes.
Is it mostly package size or is it capacitance? Like, if I can get a small or larger values in the same package, is there going to be a big difference there?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because in the past, you put like 1 microfarad and 0.1 microfarad right next to each other. So you think like the 0.1 is for high frequency and the 1 microfarad is for lower. but actually if they have the same package, the parasitic inductance is almost the same. So it makes no sense to, if the package size is the same, to use the 0.1 instead of the 1 microfarad, except maybe for cost reasons. If the 1 microfarad is much more expensive and you don't need it, then you take the 100 nanofarad. Okay, great. So I think we can have lunch. Okay, what we see here is our PCB that we want to analyze. We just want to measure the target impedance, and what we need to do is we have this probe and we need to connect it to our VNA. So I take my cables and just put them on. Of course, if you do it professionally, you should use the torque wrench like this one to tighten the SMA connection. But for now, it's okay if I do it like this. Okay, and now I connect it to the VNA. Whenever you do a VNA measurement, you usually need to do some kind of calibration, and calibration on VNAs is a big topic. But what we can do now is we can do a very simple calibration, and this type of calibration is just called normalization. So here I can also do it with the mouse. I do it here easier. So I push cal, then I push start, and then I select transmission normalization next. Okay, start, yes, and I make sure my connections are all good. Okay, and I push through. Now it's doing the calibration and it's ready, and now I apply it. Okay, now we can see we have two measurements showing up here. We don't need this measurement. Just let me remove it. Okay, and as you have seen before in the presentation, the instrument normally shows the S2-1 parameter that I select here, but we are interested in the impedance, and for most instruments you need to do this calculation manually, but here we have the option to just select the two-port shunt through measurement, and it calculates the impedance for us. And what we can see here, we have the impedance if we don't connect anything to our probe. It's just very high for low frequencies and then goes down. Another thing that we have observed on the slides is that you usually want to have the logarithmic display. So let's do this. Let's make it logarithmic format, and we select logarithmic magnitude. Okay, I've zoomed in a little bit too much. Okay, that's good. And now our frequency scale is still not logarithmic, so we need to go into the sweep and select logarithmic frequency. And yeah, if you change the scale of the frequency axis, you know, actually you need to do the calibration again, so it was not smart to do it before. I quickly do it again. Transmission. Okay, apply. So now we have this measurement on a log-log graph. What I also do to make it look like the measurement in the slide, I change the stop frequency to 500 megahertz. Okay. And now go into the right area, because we want to measure the impedance of our power distribution network, and it's usually below 1 ohm. So we expect something to show up here in this range. Good thing when you start a measurement, always expect something so you can tell if the measurement makes sense. Now I have here this 401 capacitor that is desoldered, and I put the probe onto it. Okay, we get okay, I optimize this a little bit. Okay, this looks good. This is a measurement we get, and now I plug in the power and let's see what happens. Yeah, it changes. Here it changes only a little bit. Let's try to connect it to this power bank. Maybe there is a USB problem. By the way, what I'm measuring here is the analog supply voltage, and the one I've shown you in the slide was the core voltage, so there might be a small difference. Now it's power connected, and now it's disconnected. And here, yeah, here you don't see the peak from the voltage regulator module, but whenever you connect your VNA to a PCB with the power turned on, make sure the power is not, or the voltage is not exceeding the input of your VNA. For DC voltage, here it says 30 volt DC, so we are safe. And the VNA inputs are AC coupled, so we are only measuring. And what you can see here, when I move the probe slightly because of the probe tips, is just the two center pins soldered together, the connection is not very good. It can oxidize if you keep it on air for a long time, and you have to press and move it a little bit to get a good connection. So if you want to make very high precision measurement, it's actually recommended to solder the cables directly onto your device. Now let me stop the sweep here. Okay, this is our sweep, and here we can see at the low frequencies we have quite a high impedance of our power distribution network, and that could cause ripples if we have alternating current that has maybe a frequency here of 10 kilohertz. If we want to prevent that, we would need to just calculate a capacitor value that goes through this area, so we can lower this down. And then we would have less ripple and less noise. I have done this on this PCB. As you can see here, it's a quite a big electrolyte capacitor, maybe bigger than necessary, but it's good to show the effect. Okay, I plug in the power again, and now I do the same measurement. Just remember this measurement, or I can put it into memory, add trace. Okay, good. Now it's in memory. Oh no. That was the wrong. Okay, I did not store the trace correctly, but you remember how it looked like. Now I try to make a good connection again, and what you see here is you have quite a flat target impedance. Not target impedance, PDN impedance, and that's good. You want to have a flat PDN impedance up to the corner frequency where you allow an inductive increase. Of course, a thing you should do now is evaluate how large this capacitor really needs to be, because this is quite big, and I think a smaller one will also do it. But as you have seen before, not having a electrolyte or bulk capacitor at all can be problematic in some cases. Okay, I think now we go to have lunch. I'm hungry. Yeah, noch one more question. Okay, yes.
Is this to shield away the USB noise from your measurement?
Or? So in general, yeah. Two reasons. Mostly I use it to avoid ground loops, and another reason is I don't want to connect like electronic devices that are prototypes to my oscilloscope, VNA, because this instrument is quite expensive, sure. So just to be sure.
Okay, I see.
Yeah.
Thank you.